chainsaws have become unbelievably popular in recent years. And with this popularity comes a lot of interest in obtaining some saws. There's not a week that goes by that I don't get a question somewhere along the lines of, which saw do I get first? Or do I get this saw or this saw? Or I'm confused, tell me where to begin. It's a really good question. A lot of it depends upon the type of work you're gonna do, but I think I can help you come up with a definitive answer for the first saw you should buy. Do you think you're gonna be doing a lot of rough work with handsaws? Well, if that's the case, just get one of these guys. They're everywhere. You can find them in antique stores. There's lots of great tool dealers online that will get you a really high quality handsaw. Some of them will even sell it to you already sharpened. But here's the thing. For those of us that have really taken the plunge and are now rough dimensioning all our stock with these types of saws, we tend to be pretty zealous hand tool users already and won't think twice about having 20 different saws in our shop. So this isn't really the best place to start. In fact, what you'll find is these are rough dimension tools. No matter what you do with one of these saws, you're going to be touching that surface with something else, whether it's a finer saw or a hand plane. This is probably not the place you want to start with saws. I think for the majority of you out there wondering which saw to buy first, you're thinking along the lines of bench work. Here at a bench hook or at a vise, cutting joinery or doing much more precision work. In that case, the obvious solution to me is a carcass saw. What exactly is a carcass saw? By definition, it's a saw with a cross-cut tooth geometry. The teeth will have just a bit of relaxed rake to them, making it easier to start, a little bit easier in use. Now, in case you don't know, rake is the angle that you put on the front or the cutting edge of the tooth. In a lot of rip saws, it'll be straight up and down or 0 degrees rake. In a relaxed rake, when you lean the tooth away from you, some rip saws will have about 5 degrees of rake. A lot of crosscut saws sit around 15 to even 20 degrees of rake. When the tooth first hits the wood, it's allowed to kind of ride up and over and slide through it. Makes it a lot easier to start and certainly a lot smoother in motion. The crosscut saw is also going to have some fleam to the teeth. Now the fleam, again, is the bevel that you put on the front of the tooth. A rip saw is going to have 0 degrees of fleam, so the face is going to be perpendicular to the saw plate. Fleam on a crosscut saw is going to angle the tooth ever so slightly, and every other tooth will be angled in the opposite direction. This creates a sharper, more knife-like edge and allows the saw to slice across the grain, making for a cleaner crosscut. Crosscut teeth work like knives, whereas rip teeth work more like chisels, banging into the wood and chopping wood out. This is going to slice the wood out. Now the other element of tooth geometry we have to talk about is pitch, the number of teeth per inch. And there is some debate here, but most carcass saws you're going to find are going to be around 12 to 14 points per inch. This Lee Nielsen is a 14 point per inch. These two saws are also, they're around 13 points per inch, depending on how you count it. But they're all around that medium to fine-ish cut. Again, contrast that with a dovetail saw that's going to have 15 points per inch, or in some instances, 16 points per inch. Now, don't get me wrong, you can have a rip-filed saw to do cross-cutting and vice versa, with a cross-cut saw doing ripping. But we're talking about a more precise tool here. So why not stack the cards in your favor and give you a saw that's going to slice a little bit cleaner, it's going to be a little bit easier to start, and just kind of glide through the wood just a bit easier. Here are three different carcass saws. The reason I would kind of hesitate to jump right into saying that is this Bad Axe saw technically is billed as a small tenon saw, but it's the same size. It's a 12-inch long plate, which pretty much defines the carcass saw. And there's a fair amount of depth, around 2 inches of depth underneath the back. Contrast that with a dovetail saw. Let me grab one real quick. Dovetail saw is going to be shorter, usually around 8 to 10 inches long, and it's not going to have as much depth under the back. There certainly are dovetail saws in the market now that are longer. Here's a very recently made Bad Axe stiletto saw. This has also a 12-inch blade, but you can see there's quite a bit less saw plate under the back when you compare it with one of these carcass saws. The deeper plate under the back allows for more utility of cuts. I can do through cuts on a piece of stock. I can cut 8-quarter stock easily with this. I can cut 1.5, even 2-inch long tenons using this saw. We're trying to cut a 2-inch tenon on a real narrow plate like this is going to be really difficult. So the carcass saw has a lot of features of a lot of different back saws. In a lot of respects, it can be referred to almost as like the jack plane of saws. It's a utility saw. It does a lot of different things well. And that is exactly why I recommend this being the first saw you buy. You can use this for just about anything you come across. Let me show you. So I'm going to come over to the joinery bench and I'm going to walk you through just some of the basic joints. Now it seems fitting to start with the dovetail. I hear so many times people's first saw is a dovetail saw. And you know what? That's great if you just cut a whole lot of dovetails. But let me show you. I'll grab my Lee & Nielsen carcass saw and I can plow through these dovetails just like my dovetail saw. I've laid out 3 tails here. That cuts a tail perfectly well. And with these really skinny pins, I'm just switching saws just so that I can say, no one can say, well, that's because you've got that saw. This Bont saw is reminding me that I probably need to touch up my Lee & Nielsen. Lee & Nielsen sounds and acts a little bit duller than the cut I just made with the Bont. So let's now using the Bad Axe saw. Obviously, I can cut dovetails with the same precision as if I grabbed an actual dedicated dovetail saw. And what you actually may find is that you'll be hard pressed to find a difference in the saw quality, in the cut quality, and in typical carcass style joints where you've got a thicker, this is a little bit heavier, 3/4 inch piece of cherry, but your carcasses are going to be 3/4 inch or 7/8 inch. You'll find that these lower pitched, bigger saws are going to cut through that stuff a lot faster. You may remember there were some dovetail saws in the market that were progressive pitch. And they were designed to be real fine at the tooth to be easy to start and then heavier at the back to speed up the cutting action. Just grab yourself a carcass saw and you're good to go. If I'm cutting really thin drawer sides, these carcass saws still work great. But, you know, that may be a case where you want to slide over to a specialized dovetail saw. But as we can see here, you definitely don't have to have that. My OCD is telling me that I should go ahead and finish this cut because I want to show you one other thing. I don't know why I've got this up so high in the vise. Anybody who's wondering, why has he got his arm in such weird positions? Because for some reason I've tilted it up so high. How many of you have seen somebody cut dovetails, they make all the rip cuts, and then they go and they grab a different saw in order to make the cross cut here to remove this half tail? Well, if you're already using a cross cut saw, guess what? It's just as easy to flip it onto its side. And I can pop that half tail out. And obviously, I didn't have to have a rip saw to make these rip cuts or a cross cut saw to make that cross cut. This is a perfectly clean surface. I could assemble this joint right off the saw. There's no need to come in here with a chisel. So that's the first thing, dovetails. I don't really have to have a dovetail saw. The carcass saw is going to work perfectly for me. Next, let's look at tenons. this is where the dovetail saw is just going to fall apart on you. So your typical dovetail saw is certainly going to be good because a tenon is a rip cut. But if you've got a tenon that's more than, you know, this thickness, which this is about 1.5 inches, I can think of many examples where I've cut tenons that are 2, 3, even 4 inches long. The deeper depth under the back is going to give you that kind of freedom. So this is a traditional rip cut, right? Well, the crosscut saw, it is going to feel maybe a little spongier, slide around a little bit more on a rip cut like this. But you can see, I'm right on my line here. I've got a nice clean cut. Switch saws. I've got plenty of depth under the back to complete this saw cut. It would really help if I had my knife line all the way around the board here. I'm able to make that tenon cut almost all the way to the back here. And now I'm going to cross cut out the shoulder. Well, I've already got a cross cut saw, right? There's my tenon sheet, and there's half my tenon. Look at that cut, it's perfectly clean. This would be joinery ready. I'm right on my line, all the way around the tenon. Perfect saw cut. Didn't need a dedicated tenon saw for that. Certainly wouldn't able to do that with the average dovetail saw because this tenon is it's too long. So let's take it to a little bit larger cut, like a dado. Well, this is definitely the realm of a crosscut saw. I've got this relatively long, this is about a 12-inch wide piece of mahogany here. Actually, I'm sorry, it's Spanish cedar. And I've got to make a long crosscut through here. Well, the slicing action of the crosscut teeth are certainly going to make this a much better cut than trying to power through it with a rip cut. Now this is a pretty wide board here. So having a shorter, say, dovetail saw really wouldn't make a lot of sense. Having a saw that is as wide as the case side is really useful. This is starting to stretch a little bit. If I were actually making a project here, I would probably reach for a more specialized saw like my sash saw. My sash saw is going to be a little bit longer. It's got a little bit more depth under the plate, so it actually balances nicely. It's also set a little differently, so it wants to bind in this cut. Here, I'll start on the other side. Changing saw cuts, changing saws in mid-cut is always a little hairy because the saws are going to be set a little bit differently. This is cutting a little bit wider kerf than that carcass saw. But you can see how having a longer saw like this is going to track nicely across a wider board. Having a little bit more depth under the cut, I think, also makes it easier to balance. It's that whole broom handle thing. It's real hard to balance a chisel, and don't try to balance a chisel at home, kids. It's hard to balance a chisel like this because it's relatively short. Taking something longer, like this plane mallet, is a little bit easier to balance because it's got a higher center of gravity. Nice plane mallet, huh? Sterling Tool Works. There's your product plug. So this is actually a little bit easier to make a plum cut. This is getting into a specialized tool, and if you do a lot more joinery work, you may find that's beneficial. But you can see I can cut a perfectly passable dado just using this carcass saw. And I have cut many a dado using this carcass saw for many years. Works great. I don't know how deep I've cut that, but I did do a little bit of cutting on each side. So I could just go ahead and chisel out stuff in between. Finish it up with a paring chisel or router plane or whatever. I've got a dado that's ready to go. The other thing that we're going to do down here at the bench, as compared to the joinery bench a lot more, is through cuts. Here are the dovetails I cut earlier. We'll say I wanted to cut this off, cut it exactly to size. Well, I've got a knife line that runs all the way around the board. So I'll grab my carcass saw. And just right here at the bench hook, whoops, see what happens when your body gets out of alignment and you rush? Right here at the bench hook, I can make a beautiful cross cut that probably is dead square, and dead on plumb. So, I mean, this is firmly in the crosscut saw territory because obviously I'm making crosscuts, making nice and clean crosscuts. I could clean this up with a shooting board. Got a little bit of a saw kerf there from cutting my dovetails because I cut right on the line. But these carcass saws, I mean, this is what this was intended for, cutting carcass pieces to length and cutting carcass joinery like the dado. But you can see just how easily it was able to transfer to tenons and to dovetails. So really, there are a lot of saws out there on the market. There's a lot of vintage ones that you can buy. But I think if this is going to be such a utilitarian saw, why not drop some dough and buy yourself a really high quality carcass saw? Just about every modern manufacturer of saws now makes a carcass saw. This is a Bad Axe. This is Bont's Toolworks. Here's Lee Nielsen. Certainly Veritas makes them dirt cheap, and they're high quality saws as well. I recommend spending some money on this because this should be the first saw you buy, and you never know, depending on how much handwork you do, it might even be the last saw that you buy. That is until you start to do more sawing and succumb to the inner saw zealot hidden in every single one of us. So don't get me wrong, augmenting the saw nest can certainly bring advantages with it. But you want to let your work guide that. Starting with a carcass saw will allow you to precisely dimension your parts. It will allow you to cut just about any joint you can think of. But there will be times when you wish you had something a little bit more refined. The dovetail saw certainly does come to mind. As a dedicated rip saw, it's going to cut dovetails a lot faster than, say, a cross-cut tooth carcass saw. When I started doing a little bit more furniture work and working with bigger parts, I found the cross-cut nature of this 12-inch saw wasn't quite cutting it, forgive the pun. So my solution was a sash saw. The sash saw is generally around 14 inches long, so it's got a longer plate. It's got a little bit more depth under the back. This sash saw, again, made by Bad Axe Toolworks with my fun little custom tea candle. Very proud of this saw, but this has really become my go-to saw now. I use it for just about all of the carcass work that I have to come up with. The longer saw plate allows me to cut much faster. It also allows me, I think, to make straighter cuts because I've got a longer reference edge to work on. It's a very aggressive saw. The extra depth under the back allows me to cross-cut even thick posts. It's just a fantastic saw and more appropriately sized to larger casework. But there's always going to be a time when I'm going to, say, be working on a smaller box and a big saw like this is just overkill. And reaching for my good old 12-inch carcass saw is going to be the most logical solution. This Lee Nielsen carcass saw has been with me for almost 6 years now. It still gets used on just about every single project. So you can see why the carcass saw is the first saw you should buy. There's going to be lots of other things that come along. Again, the more sawing you do, the more reason you'll find a specialized tool will be more efficient. But for the casual hand tool user, and especially for the exploratory hand tool user who's just getting into it, don't invest a bunch of money in a whole bunch of different saws. If you find you love it and you want to do more of it, then you can specialize. But until then, this jack of all trades carcass saw, it's the way to go.